Listening Library presents The Last Kids on Earth and the Doomsday Race by Max Brallier and Douglas Holgate. Read for you by Robbie Daymond.
When last the world's listeners followed the last kids on Earth.
Gross legions of near-indestructible armed skeletons held together by vine thingies? Controlled by Thrall? Aw, heck no.
Oh, heck yes, Jack Sullivan. Oh, heck yes. And now our hero's journey in search of the tower to find Thrall and...
Road trip snacks! Booyah!
A few detours were made along the way, which led to a most crucial discovery. High-performance monster weed killer. Ultra Slime. And Ultra Slime's unlikely source.
Who's a good little slime drooler? You are. Yes, you are.
Jack's zombie-controlling powers grow stronger. Or do they grow stranger? You tell him, Alfred. Blargus and the Bone Colossus are felled. But with Big Mama lost along the way, our heroes seek new means of transportation. But what is this strange creature carrying an entire mall atop its back? Who else has hitched a ride in its abandoned storefronts and discount kiosks? All aboard the Mallusk.
Cute.
Now, hopefully, constant listener, it's on to Book 7, The Last Kids on Earth and the Doomsday Race.
Doomsday. Sigh. Sounds like we are in for another doozy, boys. But we're going to the mall, remember? Who doesn't love a mall? We first met Thrall at a mall.
Oh, come on. You think we'll see Thrall at this mall, too? No way. Not a chance. Definitely zero chance.
Chapter 1. Jack, we gotta go. Now! I'm pumping gas into my boom cart. June's telling me there's no time. And I know there's no time. I know that the Mallusk, an enormous centipede monster carrying the Millennium Super Mall on its back, is barreling toward us. Man, I wish I could go back to 3 minutes ago. 3 minutes ago, things were good. Me and my friends, Quint, June, and Dirk, were good. We were mid-road trip and celebrating a hard-won victory at Aqua City Water Park. We had defeated the monster Blargus, survived Thrall's skeleton army, and escaped with Drooler. Drooler, the odd-looking little creature who secretes the strange liquid Ultra Slime. And that strange liquid is, maybe, the key to defeating Thrall once and for all. Yep, 3 minutes ago was a Kodak moment. But then came the rumbling, like a thunderstorm giving birth to an earthquake. The world started shaking. My inside started quivering, because we saw it. The Mallusk, June gasped. It's back!
Which means we gotta get back to driving, Dirk said. And fast.
So, right now, my friends are in their boom carts, engines running. But I'm still pumping gas. Actually, wait, no. I only look like I'm pumping gas. I'm actually just standing at the pump in a half trance, staring at my hand. Not my normal hand. The cosmic hand. The cosmic hand is the sucker-covered monster tentacle glove that is forever wrapped around my wrist and hand. Without it, I can't wield my baseball blade, the Louisville Slicer. And it's the Louisville Slicer that contains the power to command and control zombies. I'm staring at the cosmic hand now because I'm realizing it has changed. It looks more, I don't know, substantial. And it feels different. And I think I know what caused this change. Back at Aqua City, I did something huge. I controlled a zombie without the Louisville Slicer. For the first time ever, I controlled a zombie with my mind. What was I thinking? Where did the idea to even attempt to control zombies with my mind come from? The Louisville slicer contains the power to control zombies, yes, but it works in a very specific way. I say the stuff I want the zombies to do, and then I swing the bat, and the zombies do the stuff. But it is not a shut my eyes and think real hard with my mind and then talk to zombies with my mind telepathy type mind thing. That it even occurred to me to try using my mind is just weird. It'd be like sitting on the couch playing Mario, pounding the controller, and then thinking, hey, you know what? Forget the controller. I'll just control Mario with my mind. But that's what I did. And it worked. I controlled a zombie with my mind. And I have to tell my friends. Guys, I didn't tell you. Back at the water park, I used, like, brain powers to...
Dude!
Dirk shouts, do you see that mollusk? We have to go now! But this is... Screech! June peels out, leaving burnt rubber in her wake. She cuts the wheel, stomping the pedal, speeding toward me. Get in your cart and drive! June barks. Okay, fine, jeez, I mutter. Message received. Only had to say it once. Now, Jack! June orders. And this time, I listen. The pump clangs to the ground as I jump behind the wheel of my boom cart. I wave the Louisville slicer and shout a command to my zombies. Alfred, Lefty, Glurm, climb on. My zombie trio responds, hopping on the bumper and grabbing the boom cart's rear cage. I stomp the gas and the tires scream. I'm speeding away from the station, following June, Quint, and Dirk out onto the interstate as...
Crunch!
The sound of the mollusk ramming into the gas station is like a sonic boom of annihilation. Rocket hurling our boom carts ahead.
Ba-boom!
That thing is going to grind our bones into little tiny bone bits! Like bird bones. Guys, you gotta listen to me! I controlled Alfred only by thinking about it. No slicer. And I think...
Not now, Jack.
I'm trying to tell you something, guys, I shout. Something big.
Not bigger than that,
Dirk barks, hooking a thumb at the mollusk. Debatable, I shout. Bigger in size. Well, duh. Of course the mollusk is bigger, but bigger in terms of, like, impact on us? I'm not sure. Jack, there is quite literally nothing that will have a bigger impact on us than that thing when it impacts on us, Quint shouts. Heads up, June cries as the wide avenue narrows, shooting us onto a small town main street. Dirk and June blast forward while Quint and I keep pace side by side. We speed down post-apocalyptic streets, engines churning, keeping us just ahead of the charging mollusk. Quint! I shout. We need to talk about what I did back at the water park. It was incredible! Quint exclaims. I know! Thank you! I mean, I controlled Alfred just by thinking about it. Dude, am I Jean Grey? No, friend. Not that. Look! Quint says, lifting one hand from the wheel and pointing at Dirk directly ahead of us. Dirk's sword is slung over his back, and clinging to the sword's hilt is Drooler. Tiny droplets of ultra slime fly off the monster. Yeah, yeah, Dirk has a cool new sword, we're all jealous, whatever. I'm trying to tell you that I might be a mind reader. Or, no, the opposite.
A reverse mind reader,
a mind teller. Unbelievable. Believe it, buddy, cause... Slime should be pouring off Drooler in buckets, but it's not. Forget Drooler, I exclaim. How are you not interested in the world-altering stuff that... I am interested, Jack. I am incredibly interested in the world-altering stuff that Drooler is doing. Just then, Dirk swerves to avoid a toppling streetlight. His cart bangs into mine, and then he's speeding along beside us. Dirk! Quint exclaims. I've had the most incredible realization.
Me too,
Dirk says.
I've realized you two talk way too much during speeding getaways. Focus on staying alive and keep your mouths
closed, Quint says. A closed circuit. Combined, that's what Drooler and your sword form. That's why he hugs the hilt like that. Look, the ultra slime seeps from Drooler, trickles down the sword, then flows back up into Drooler for reabsorption, like electricity or evaporation. Dirk glances back at Drooler, over to Quint, then back at Drooler, then...
Why does this matter right now?
Dirk shouts. Because, scientifically, I'm gonna have to separate you three if you don't stop talking, June shouts, throwing us a hard look over her shoulder. Now listen. See that highway on-ramp up ahead? If we can get to that, we might escape the mollusk, and we might not die today. I squint. June's right. The looping ramp will carry us out of the mollusk's path, and that means we'll survive. And that also means I'll be able to finish one complete thought without being interrupted by a lesson on the science of ultra slime. I smile. One day this will all be a distant memory, a blip on the radar, a fun story we'll tell our robot grandkids. And then, in an instant, it all falls apart. Exhaust erupts ahead of me, June's boom cart belching smoke. Then Quint's and Dirk's boom carts begin shuddering and shaking. Then my own engine rattles. I glance down at the dash. Gas tank is empty. Well, this is unfortunate timing, Quint says. The street sways and buckles. Pavement splits. Stores crumble, street lamps fall. I feel the sharp sting of concrete pelting me like a rubble rain shower. The mollusk's shadow.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.